We've been using minimum till in the veg side of the business since 2009, which is 6 years now. There's a lot of theory out there about what you should be doing, and we had to adapt that theory to whatever was practical for us. We looked at our bedding system and went into a permanent bed situation, so to minimise our wheel tracks, to minimise the compaction, and then we were able to keep all the trash in one spot and incorporate it and try and build a tilth in the bed. The management of the stubble was the key. How were we able to manage that residue well enough to be able to get back in and sow and get a perfect stand again? And that was the biggest issue that we struck. And then I went on a trip to the US, and one of the things I went and saw was some equipment to manage residue in processing tomatoes. It was a thing called a soil reformer. It was developed by UC Davis. And we took a bit of a gamble because there weren't any here, and we imported one. Forms our beds up to start with. We can go over with a second pass and can incorporate herbicides or insecticides or fungicides if we need to incorporate them into the soil. It can leave a bed good enough to transplant into easily. We have direct seeded behind it, so it can leave a very fine bed. Once the crop is harvested and we've got crop residue there, we use it to go through and chop up and incorporate the trash that's left. So it's got a row of coulters at the front which cut along the bed. Then we have, we can put tines in to work the bed, and then behind that it has paddles which are ground driven with blades on them that chop and incorporate the residue that's behind. So, and then bed formers behind that. So it does a few jobs in one pass. It doesn't require as much horsepower because it's ground driven, not PTO driven. And you know, it's versatile. There's a lot of things that you can change on it. We can pull the points out if we need to. I can change how aggressive the paddles are at the back, or I can change the depth of the furrows and everything. So it's really versatile bit of gear. Actually now, I don't think, I can't imagine how we'd operate without it, to be honest. These days, basically everything here is GPS'd. So all the rows are pulled up GPS. It's all with RTK, so that in 10 years' time, I can go straight in on the same lines as before. What that means is it actually takes permanent beds to another step, because this year we had a block that had permanent beds from 2009 until this year that we then put in with Calianti mustard. So the Calianti needed to be incorporated with a disc plough and rolled and sealed. And because of GPS and RTK, we'll go back in and pull beds up straight over the top of where they were before. So essentially, it's very similar to a permanent bed situation in that our compaction is still in the same spot in the furrow where you really want it, to be honest, because you don't want the tractor disappearing if it gets a bit wet. Everyone's soil is slightly different. Everyone's climate is different. People grow different crops on different configurations. It's not one head fits all. What we've found is a combination of a humus compost, so not just mulch, but a humus compost, and the cover cropping and the permanent bedding has really enhanced the soil. And for us, they have to go hand in hand.
We're using it because we're trying to improve the soil health, to introduce beneficial fungi and bacteria. We're using it to try to build our organic carbon levels. We're talking about compost using several different feedstocks, looking for a carbon to nitrogen ratio of those feedstocks of around about 30 to 40 to 1, and then going through a thermophilic process where you're monitoring the temperature and the CO2 level of the compost and turning it very regularly in the initial stages, and then reaching maturity in somewhere between 8 to 12 weeks. It's not complicated as such. It's more a material management process, but it's fairly hands-on and it's fairly intensive.
We generally try to keep as much cover on the ground as we can until we're ready to come in and get ready for sowing. Particularly ryegrass, their root system is massive and it's sort of the king as far as building structure is concerned. Well, if we finish our cropping cycle of whatever our cash crop is, come in and use the same bed, sow in ryegrass. The ryegrass grows steadily through winter and then fairly rapid growth in the spring. Before it goes to seed, we spray it out and just leave it standing. And then here over summer, where we can get weeks on end of over 35 degrees, no humidity, the ryegrass stands and just basically falls over on the soil and makes a thatch. And all the microbes have got the root mass to feed on underneath that thatch. So then we're now towards the end of summer and we need to get into the block to start planting in a few weeks. We'll start incorporating it in. So the trick is to go in when it's hot and quite brittle, so everything sort of smashes up and becomes easy to manage. And one or two passes with the reformer and then we're good enough to get a bed that we can precision sow into.
Increased pest pressure when you're retaining trash can be an issue. In that regard, it's more a matter of identifying which crops are going to potentially have an issue and then trying to reduce our trash level earlier prior to planting. Disease can be an issue as well. Then the certain species that you're growing in the cover crop, you take that into account. And weed pressure in a minimum till situation is certainly a problem. But growing a cover crop is a great weed suppressant. And our herbicide use here has been pretty minimal. We've had one spray over summer and that's it, and it's pretty clean. There's hardly anything here. As opposed to a bare fallow, which is just covered in weeds. I don't think weed pressure is such an issue when you're using cover cropping.
There's no point in having the best dirt in the district if you go broke. So you have to make sure that it's financially viable. You have to make sure you're making money out of it. So we looked at it in a 5-year time frame, and we've come out the other end of that five-year time frame in a much better position than we were when we started. What we have to look at is just the small increases in the margins initially in the crops that we're growing, to a point where the margins are considerably higher and the input costs are less. We have to get to that point. And I remember thinking, God, I don't know, 3 or 4 years we've got to, until we're going to see any benefit, and we might not see it. Oh, I don't like the sound of this. But in the long run, it's worked really well for us. And we're now seeing the benefit of it in great crops.